Welcome to the Victoria Beale YouTube channel. Another amazing business interview today. A lady whose surname I don't even know, and a lady who, in our conversations, we've shared some incredible experiences. I will let you decide for yourself by presenting for you the great Tracy C M. Tracy, hello.
Hey, Jonathan. Thank you so much for having me. I'm delighted. I'm so honored to be here. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Now, basically, we're going to talk about your audiobooks and your storytelling for businesses later on. But before we start, what is it about your youth that's made you so potent in your adult life?
My childhood, I actually don't have much memory of my childhood until I was five. I think I lost most of my memories, although people used to tell me that, you know, the majority of the children don't remember anything before five. Mm. But I have people around me, they remember the things back when they were two, three, four. But I basically had no memories until I turned five.
Okay.
So I knew the moment I had my scar, you probably can see right here, it's the time I started to remember things, because I still remember the motion, the pulling. I got four stitches because I fell on the ground hitting something like a triangular.
Ooh.
And yeah, it was cut right there. And I just knew that I was taken to two different clinics. The first ones, you know, basically told my parents, it's too severe, we can't handle, you have to go to the nearby town. So I was taken there with a cloth, I don't remember anything, maybe a towel holding, you know, pressing down. And I think I saw a lot of, you know, red color there, but there was no pain. And now I understand more why I had no pain, because my sensors all shut off at the moment because of the impact.
Oh.
Yes, I didn't know that until I saw my own son 2 years ago. He had a similar occurrence. And he also said, Mom, I'm not hurting. Yeah, yes. For the person who is experiencing the trauma, they don't feel the pain. But people who's witnessing, we are seeing it. It was so painful.
Yes.
Yeah. And at that moment, I realized that's how much pain my parents had to go through. And from that moment on, I remembered everything.
So basically, a pretty strong visceral emotion for your first definite memory. And kind
yes.
of like, yeah. So that is really good. Will you tell me what the CM stands for?
Oh, C is my last name, my maiden name. I'm married, but I prefer my maiden name. C stands, CAO is my Chinese last name.
Okay.
And M is not really connecting to C, because there's a some certain requirement on LinkedIn. On
yeah.
my profile, they have to, you know, if you have other name you put in. So I've been playing that a little bit.
No.
And I think there's a C dot M stands for my highest educational degree, which is Master in Hospitality Management. I did graduate from my graduate school. I have this specialized MBA. It's called Master of Hospitality Management. It's basically MBA in the hotel industry.
Lots of hard work dealing with lots of complaints and learning about people.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
hotel industry is all about experience. It's not just a service or a product. It's service and product together.
So here's the thing. We spoke a couple of times, exchanged some messages, and we were just talking before the record, and I went, oh, I didn't think you were dyslexic at the beginning. And you went, oh, yeah, I didn't think I was either. And then I read out, because I am dyslexic, I read out these attributes of the brain in dyslexic minds, which I'll read in a minute. But do you feel you are dyslexic by definition or something else?
I don't think I'm dyslexic by definition, because the definition says having difficulty read and understand, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, maybe I'm discussing the definition because I read okay, but having difficulty reading doesn't mean you really just read slowly. For me, I read too fast. I mean, I basically, for me to read the things, I'm basically glancing. You know, I'd read the subtitles, and then maybe the first or second sentences, I'm down to the bottom. That's how fast I can read. And by doing that, I think I'm skipping a lot of material because I grew up in Chinese culture, our vocabulary is super small. Honestly, you just need 500 characters and you're done. And all the others are combination into words, phrases, sentences, paragraphs. But moving toward to English, when I started my English lessons at the age of 11, English has 200,000 vocabulary.
I
And
know.
it's totally different. It was the spelling, everything, because Chinese character basically build little building, right? So that's two different systems. And because we have to remember so many words every day, yeah, it was very intense. And I think I'm just like moving out of my little character building houses into this spelling realm. And that's the time I think I really start to have a little bit problem. I know words, I know phrases, I know sentences, but when sentences were put together, I had a hard time to understand the meaning of it. You know, all those superficial meaning of the words are understandable, but when I took my TOEFL, when I took my GRE, I failed. Well, I won't say fail. I passed. I had a passing. Yeah, 60%, and I didn't got into my graduate school, but it was conditional because my score was kind of low. The entire student body was like 80, 90%. I was like 60, 70%. So they were like, yeah, my counselor said, we will accept you, but it will be conditional. And you have to prove yourself you can really learn. Yes, I did. I got, I think, 3.7 or 8 GPA, you know, because our course was very demanding. It's not only you have to score in the classroom, you have to really do get back in the hotel. It's a 2-year program. You have the practicum 1 and 2 alongside with all this coursework going through graduate school. So I did decently. And I think as far as 3 or 6 months into those conditional acceptance, I was like made official. And I was, okay, I really can learn.
So your intelligence was never a question. It's the application of a completely separate language system. So it's unsurprising to me. And what does surprise me is that you would describe a pass grade as a fail, but it also tells me how absolutely excellent you are at doing what we're going to be talking about in a moment. I will maybe read out the thing from the gift of dyslexia attributes, but both your children have struggled in different ways. So, do you think? So, like, I'm 52. When I was at school, dyslexia wasn't a thing. You were just stupid or disruptive, put in the back of the class and just written off. Dyslexia became fashionable about 85, 1985. And since then, it's gone on, and various other conditions have been labeled. Do you think your children learn best from auditory material?
I would say school teaching. We do have a lot of called a SPICE program, but my kids, they're not qualified. Yeah, school focusing on Down syndrome kids and the ones that are very apparent having learning difficulties. Because my kids are in private school, so we have very limited resource. And I wish they had a public school resource. They will be able to test them and refer them to a speech therapist. Both of my boys had trouble reading because I was the primary reader to them. I didn't know because they were pretty much on the listening side, and there was not much interaction before they turned 6 or 7 when I start to try a little bit of vocabulary and allow them to read. And, you know, I read one sentence, they read the other. And by leading them, I feel they can learn better. But then by leading them, I found out that, oh, these boys, they skip all these conjunctions, connecting, linking words. And I to them, it was not a problem because they can understand lots of things easily because it's mainly all fiction books, right? Those things don't really make a lot of sense. But when I moved toward to fiction, I'm sorry, nonfiction, yeah, that's the problem because there's then after because and they were like, Mom, I think you need to reread, yeah, because those logic connections they are yeah very important in those words. They really make a difference, and then and they don't like to read nonfiction. Because it's not fun, right? And there's no emotion. And both of them had a problem with the science. And I took them for the entire summer, read their science book, one chapter at a time. And we both felt miserable. Yeah, I told them techniques. You can read the first, you know, what's the topic about. And if you don't want to go through the details, let's jump all the way to the bottom to see the conclusion. Still, for them, it's like, Mom, I like to look at the pictures. Yeah, they all enjoy picture reading. And in school, we have a lot of graphic novels. Graphic novel is a compromise from comic books to chapter books, right? Bridging up. I know it helps a lot of kids, but still, being graphic, people don't look at words anymore.
No,
Okay,
they
I
look at
get
the image.
80% of the picture. Why do I have to bother to read through lines and lines? Yeah. And that's the thing in how you balance using that as your transition into their chapter reading or have kids just indulge them into this graphic. My kid will go to directly to the graphic and comic section because that's where they enjoy reading the most.
I
Honestly, we're not
found
going to libraries anymore because I know where they are going.
I found with children that were dyslexic in when I was in primary education, they would learn a book, so they'd like to reread the same book over and over because they'd learnt the words and they could say it without thinking. But so when you write down in English, do you miss connecting words, conjunctive words, things like that?
I used to
But you don't now.
skip and or a lot, but then now I pay more attention to these words. I will list you know the words I often miss, put it on the side, I know double check. And nowadays, you know, what I'm missing is not NOT all the time. And because I'm the Chinese, we like to talk in double negatives. Missing a lot is a whole different thing. You convey a different meaning. So I often go back, you know, when you talk to me, you saw me editing a lot, right? Because I keep on missing those words. I need to go back immediately, add something else. And then with my phone, I found out because I use iPhone, it also has this feature that you can edit before the person reads your text.
Very
And
good.
that helps me a lot. Otherwise, I have to send another message, like, this is the correction of the
Yeah, I've done that. I tell you what I use actually. I use Grammarly, and it's just amazing. Totally amazing. So, you're basically going to be offering your, well, what you've conceived of is an understanding that narrative and story is the main way to connect with and engage people. So, your service offering, if I'm looking at this video right now and you look right down the camera at me, what is it you're going to be doing?
I found out that I can reach my audience through voice not too long ago. It's like a 45 days ago when I started doing my chapters reading for a biography, autobiography author who happens to be my husband. And I had a problem reading through his chapters, honestly, because he's writing a documentary other than biography. So I said, you know, don't complain anymore because it has been 2 years that I couldn't go through his chapter one. And I said, let me do it reading to you. Maybe by voicing it out, it will help me, because it does. Every time if I have problem reading a book, I will just start reading to another person. You know, there might be no people at all. I could be reading to a puppy or any object. You know, I have to have a target so I can start reading that to myself and to the audience, and then start recording. And after I record, I think, oh, let's just publish it. Maybe people will be interested in it, because there are certain value in his story. And then I started to do this because his book was written in Chinese. So I got onto the Chinese platform. I used to be a listener. I listened to lots of very interesting books there. But the platform offers one user with two different
devices.
User portal, the user and the producer. So I became a producer, and I keep on contributing at least 3 chapters per day. So I finished 106 episodes not too long ago. Yeah. Alongside that, I pick up some other books, a book from a friend of mine's daughter who's sophomore year in Duke University in the States. She majored in communications. I got her permission. I said, Claire, can I read your book? Because your book is interesting. It might just, you know, bring some value to the kids of her age at the time she published the book at the age of 11. Yes, there's very, very substantial content there. And sometimes I even cry because I connected to those the contents, the stories. You know, she had a fairy tale, fables, short essay, poetry, everything at the age of 11. I believe she started writing at the age of 7. So from 7 to 11, you know, that's a very important age, from a kid to a preteen. Yeah, and because kids are more mature nowadays, I would say close to teenage. So I like the book. I finished that book too. And also I was reading, okay, bring down to the bottom line our literature. So I also read a abridged, shortened, simplified David Copperfield, which really touched my heart, because I read the thick version, was kind of tiring. But with this shortened one for easy reading, I appreciate everything they... It's a very well-written book. It has, I would say, 90% of stuff in it from the classic. And all those three books made a huge difference and made me realize I could approach a bigger audience who's more comfortable with their time and learning, the ways of learning. So I have this 7 to 10 year group, and also older generation and baby boomers, and in between this classic, people can all somehow relate, because at different time of their life they can learn something from classics. That's how I've been so far.
So you did you say 106 episodes?
106,
and
with
episodes.
The average 6 minutes each. So
okay.
Quite a long time.
And this stuff is to help dyslexic children to get another way of absorbing the information, yeah?
I think so. I think for people who don't learn really well by visual, they can supplement by listening.
Yes.
At least to pick up something that they do not see in the text.
Yes. Yes, that is excellent. And any help for dyslexic people, I think, is a good thing. Although I will say that it was the struggle of not being able to read that pushed me into needing to read. So it's always the quandary. Because you're of Chinese descent, is there a community of businesses, Chinese businesses or Chinese-run businesses around your area?
Yes, and then there are quite active people around me are mainly bilingual. I will not say truly bilingual, because I don't think there are any truly bilingual people. There's always the dominant, and there's a bit a weaker side. I will say my Chinese is more stronger. I can only say I'm para-native speaking in English, because there's things I can never understand. You know, those syntax and
Not
certain things.
Yet.
No, yet. Okay. just, not being in a language environment at a younger age, there are things missing.
Absolutely.
Same things as you learn, as a visual learner, 70% of us not being able to read at the age from 4 to 7, there are also things missing there. But by listening, supplementing, it will help tremendously. That's how I felt myself because I learned how to read probably around 3 and 4. I don't really remember, but my parents and my grandparents, they've been telling me that I was able to read newspaper to them by listening to radio. I don't know how. Okay, but those words just jumped at me. I feel like I know these words, I know how to say it. I might not be accurate 100%, but I would say decent 60, 70% because the Chinese characters are pretty much sound binding the majority of the vocabulary just by putting different parts together. If you know half of it, you pretty much know how to sound. It's kind of like a Spanish. The way
Yes.
you see it, you know how to sound that, and you know the meaning by keep on repeating the sound. Yeah, that's how Chinese kids used to learn poetry. We keep on repeating it. We don't really know, but eventually, after like 20, 30, 40, 50 times, the meaning came to you.
Yes, understood.
Yeah.
So, would I be correct in thinking that a good customer base for what you're now offering would be maybe Chinese-owned businesses because they can't articulate what they want to. So if they were speaking Chinese or talking to the Chinese people, easy peasy. But if they're a mixed community where there are English people and people with bilingual, an audio description of their service seems to me to be a real bonus.
Yes, I will say the majority of the Chinese business in America, they have no voice. They can do advertisement in newspaper. They can hire a translator or interpreter for them to speak, but they like to blend in to American culture. Do not show off your culture heritage, and there's a historical reason for it because there's a anti-Chinese act in history.
And
Then we also
Japanese.
been through that through World War II when we saw what happened to the Japanese immigrants here. We learned from history that do not show off, be modest, talk in the language people understand. Do not advocate your culture. But with Chinese, the country's on the rise, there are lots of things you cannot avoid. People will be asking you, are you Chinese or are you Chinese affiliated? You have to be forced to take a stand, which I'm called upon. I'm a 50%, I would say I'm a 51% Chinese, 49% American, because I benefit from both education systems. I came here for my graduate school, and the country welcomed me with open arms. I was given scholarship opportunities tremendously. My undergrad and elementary high school education was offered by my country, the Chinese government, and paid very, very little money. But American just offered me so much more without was able to contribute anything at all. And I truly appreciate that's what this country is all about. It always welcome people who's hardworking, having a dream, and they want to contribute to make this country greater. And that's
Excellent.
the true spirit here.
Excellent. And I don't know if you do specific gratitude practice, but what you just explained to me was how grateful you are for your opportunities. So what I'd say to business owners out there, Tracy C M, who won't you have listened to the beginning of the podcast to find out what the C M means, but Tracy C M is a person that you should connect with today because she will be able to understand you if you're Chinese descent or Chinese immigrant, understand your idea properly, And then her ability to translate that into a story, whether it's in Chinese or American, is going to be the difference. Because look, we're all walking around all day scrolling on a phone like this, scrolling, and we only ever click on something if it's interesting. So interesting is the story of why you are in business, not you, Tracy, but why you, the business owner, are in business. And Tracy is the bridge between where you are now and where you want to be in the way that customers understand what you're saying. And hey, listen, I only interview people that I find incredible. So it's already a given that Tracy's incredible. We are going to play her favorite song, which is When You Believe by Mariah Carey and Whitney Houston. I will say the last interview I recorded, YouTube or the content owner wouldn't allow the song when I uploaded it. So if it allows it, you'll hear When You Believe. If it doesn't allow it, the interview will cut off with Tracy saying goodbye, which I invite you, Tracy, to say goodbye now with any closing statements.
Thank you so much. I'm so grateful, Jonathan. Across ocean, Atlantic, we made the connection. And I was not aware that I'm dyslexic until I met you. I'm so grateful. Finding myself, discovery, recreating myself is a big thing now. I'm not a very active LinkedIn user compared to many here who devote their time, I would say maybe their whole day, their whole night here. I wasn't very active until I would say 2022. And there were a lot of things going on the platform. You know, with any platform, there are things like that, you know, robots flying around. And I said, I'm not ready for the chaos. So I stayed away intentionally for a year and a half. But then I think coming back in September, not too long ago, I realized, hey, this platform changed. And I think it, the entire internet or the security or maybe the consensus changed. You know, we need to guard the users and we need to protect the business better. Maybe technology advanced, and I wasn't really into the security side, but I'm interested now to find out how each platform protecting them, because I'm doing audios and might be doing this a lot with youngsters. I need to know the user security, safety, all the things the platform can offer. And I'm happy to see that this platform, LinkedIn, is thriving because I'm pretty much LinkedIn only. I can't deal with a multi-platform, but I'm looking into YouTube and podcasts because these are the platforms that might offer me a better way to reach my audience. And I really want to have this wide exposure that I will be able to reach out the people who need auditory learning that will supplement their traditional learning, which seems to be challenging. I'm mainly on the Chinese side right now because that's how I started, and they offer episode by episode, and I appreciate that. And podcast also offers episode by episode. Audible seems to be you have to have the entire book recorded and coming over. I think that's a little bit different, but it might be a better option for shorter or some certain books, but I will look into that. But thank you, Jonathan, for offering this opportunity, helping me to discover myself, sharing my stories, and hopefully that will reconnect myself with people who are in the similar situation, or you don't really know what you had in the past. Like Jonathan, you said that you didn't even know you were dyslexic until you were 46. I'm about the same age. So I do really appreciate, you know, people, you know, who are willing to just looking into a new area. You don't really know what's going to come out for you, which I just like I made a connection, Jonathan. I think, okay, he seems to be pretty interesting. He's doing this potency world. What is that about? Because I'm curious. And it's curiosity. Help me. Just we might be opening up a different arena for both of us, for the
Well,
people who are listening or watching us. You never know.
Well, I'm extremely grateful for your presence. Thank you for the recording. And watchers out there, connect with Tracy. I'll put her LinkedIn details in there and any of her contact information. And as I say, hopefully you'll get to hear the song. But if not, have a great day and I'll see you again.